like to introduce today Dr. Dan. Do you pronounce it German?
Yes.
Dr. Dan German Blazer, who's a J.P. Gibbons Professor of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences and the Vice Chair for Education and Academic Affairs. Now hold your breath, guys, because this is going to be really, really long. He's a professor of community and family medicine and head of the University Council on Aging and Human Development. And Dr. Blazer also serves as an adjunct professor in the Department of Epidemiology, School of Public Health, University of North Carolina. Dr. Blazer got his BA at Vanderbilt University, his MD at Memphis, Tennessee, MPH in the University of North Carolina, PhD in the University of North Carolina. Following 9 years in academic administration, 2 as the chairman of the Department of Psychiatry, and 7 as the dean of medical education at Duke University Medical School, Dr. Blazer returned to teaching and research practice in 1999. He was a fellow at the Center for Advanced Studies of Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University. He is the author or editor of 34 books. He's the author or co-author of over 190 published abstracts and over 350 peer-reviewed articles. He is also the author and co-author of over 160 book chapters. Many of the book chapters and scientific articles are on topics of late life depression, epidemiology, consultation liaison psychiatry, and the interface between religion and psychiatry. Dr. Blazer has been the principal investigator on many projects funded by federal grants, state grants, and grants by private foundations. And many of these focus on the prevalence of physical and mental illness in the elderly, such as the Epidemiological Catchment Area Project and the established populations for epidemiological studies of the elderly. He's got a lot of accolades. Dr. Blazer is currently, we know him best right now, currently the PI at the Data and Statistical Coordinating Center for the Clinical Trials Network of the National Institute of Drug Abuse. That's just the start. Among the honors received by Dr. Blazer, he's the recipient of a Research Career Development Award from the National Institute of Mental Health, listing in Who's Who in America, Who's Who in the World, Who's Who in American Men and Women of Science, and the Best Doctors in America. He's an honored teaching professor in the Department of Psychiatry, recipient award fellowship in the American College of Psychiatry and Gerontological Society of America, and the Distinguished Life Fellowship in the American Psychiatric Association. Dr. Blazer is a member of the Epidemiology and Disease Control Review Committee at NIH and has served as its chairman from July 1988 to July 1989. He's the past chairman of the board and president of the American Geriatric Society and past psychiatry and the Archives of General Psychiatry editorial boards. He's a co-author of Aging and Mental Health and the editor of Duke Medicine Health News. I'm not going to go on and on except to say I want to introduce Dr. Blazer. He is an incredible researcher. He's an incredible academician, I think is the way that you pronounce it. But more than that, with all his accolades, he is the finest human being it has ever been my pleasure to work with and to know. Dr. Blazer.
All right. Yeah, I really appreciate Peggy's comments. And in some ways, maybe the way you can summarize it, all of that is that I'm old. But old comes with privileges, and one is that I don't have to wear a tie for this presentation. So what I want to talk to you about today is Alzheimer's disease, and I want to sort of do a disclosure initially. The disclosure is I really don't do research in this area. So I'm going to be talking with you as someone who is a geriatric psychiatrist who works with Alzheimer patients and who tries to keep up with the field. And in that process, process, I hope that I can help you try to understand what I think is one of the major public health issues that we are facing for the 21st century. But beyond that, I think it also represents something else, and that is Alzheimer's disease is an area where probably more neurobiological work has been done over the past 30 years than any other area. And so this has been perhaps the stimulus for so much that's happened in neurobiology and the neurosciences. And so understanding Alzheimer's disease, I think, is very important, and understanding sort of where we've come in this area. So this all starts with Alice Alzheimer, who back in 1906 was treating a woman who had early dementia. She was in her 50s, and she died prematurely. He did an autopsy of her brain, and in that autopsy, he found a couple of things. The first thing he found were what they call senile plaques. This may be a little bit difficult for you to see, but these are, if you can actually even see these without a microscope. All you need to do is just look at a cut of a brain, and you can see these things that look like little hard beads in the brain. These are called plaques. They're made up of amyloid, beta amyloid. We'll come back and talk about that in just a moment. But this is one of the things he saw. He also saw, He also saw these things that are called neurofibrillary tangles. And these are nerve cells and in the brain. And what he found was that when he stained these particular brains, he saw an increased frequency of these kind of very dark stains. Now, what we know since that time is what he's actually picking up, in fact, are sort of disjointed nerve cells. If you remember, your nerve cell kind of looks like this, and these are the dendrites out here, this is the cell body, and the axon comes down here. This goes all the way back to high school biology. Okay, now, running through this entire process are things they call neurofibrils, and these little tubes that bring information from the body of the nerve cell down to through the axon to the end of the nerve cell, and then the chemicals in that nerve cell then are excreted, attached to the nerve cell that it connects to, and that's how transmission takes place. With neurofibrillary tangles, what happens is that these particular fibrils start lapping around one another. And so that's why we see this very dark picture. He recognized that this was abnormal, and so this was just called presenile dementia, and later received the name of Alzheimer's disease. Now, I can remember when I was in training some time ago, back in the early 1970s, that Alzheimer's disease was something that affected individuals under the age of 65. Very similar in characteristic to what Alzheimer described in 1906. And then if you had a dementing process after the age of 65, it was a normal thing that you would expect with aging. In 1977, and I actually happened to be at this conference, NIMH convened a large conference where they looked at the data and looked at the evidence. And what was found is that the clinical symptoms and the neuropathologic findings in what Alzheimer had seen in 1906 and what we saw in dementia in individuals, say, 85 years of age, was identical. You could not distinguish the two. And so with kind of one fell swoop, the term Alzheimer's disease now captures an incredibly larger group of individuals. With that capture of so many individuals, this all of a sudden becomes a major public health problem, and that in turn stimulates 30 years now of incredible increases in research. So it's important to kind of know that history, to kind of know why we've seen just so much growth in this particular area, and why what I learned when I was a resident is totally irrelevant to sort of what we see today with Alzheimer's disease. Now, what are the clinical characteristics? I can't see that thing up there, so excuse me for having to turn around. It's basically includes memory impairment, but you don't just have memory impairment. You almost always will have something else going along with it. And they can include aphasia, which means having trouble speaking that's specifically having difficulty calling words. It can include apraxia. This is the difficulty of doing certain motor activities, such as maybe typing or putting a key in a lock or something like this. Agnosia, not recognizing objects. In other words, showing somebody a watch and they don't really recognize what that is. And disturbances in executive functioning. This is being able to plan ahead, etc. When you interview an individual about Alzheimer's disease, what immediately may be apparent to you is the memory problem. And you may see the aphasia, but just bring the family in the room, and then you'll begin to hear them talking about, she can't plan now, and that's really creating a lot of problems for us. In fact, that may be the most important problem that she looks for. These changes are clearly lead to dysfunction. I'm not going to dwell on this right now. Alzheimer's disease, almost by definition, though, is of very gradual onset. So nobody can tell you exactly when family or patient they begin to have problems. However, at some point, family usually is the first to recognize something is not right here, and then that's sometime after that is when we as clinicians begin to see these individuals. So what about the frequency and clinical course of Alzheimer's disease? Well, I could give you an overall figure, and that is something like 10% of people over the age of 65 will have signs of Alzheimer's disease, may not be have reached the stage where we might consider them to be, you know, significant clinically, but they've reached that stage. That tells you nothing, because this is not something you can just fit into a particular age category. What you've got to look at is how this varies by age, and this really shows you the picture right here. So if you're 60 to 65, or 65 to 69, I'm about 2 months ready to move into the 65 to 69 group, the frequency of Alzheimer's disease is very low. But with each succeeding year, your likelihood of developing Alzheimer's disease goes up. And we know this to be true on the way up to the 90s. And if you look at individuals 90 and above, you could probably make the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease in about half of them. And so dramatic changes between 65 and say 90. So we just need to kind of keep in mind this this dramatic increase with age. And we'll come back and talk about this a little bit more, because it has a lot to do with our therapeutic strategies related to Alzheimer's disease. Yes?
Now, are those symptoms or the diagnosis, is that now based on, you can only really definitively base it on brain autopsy, correct?
That's right. And you really can't even totally base it there. But now with these symptoms and relating them to what we think would be relatively clear ideas of what the brain pathology should look like, and it's not so much whether the plaques and tangles are there. Every older person has plaques and tangles. It's where they're located. But we think that we're probably 90% accurate when we use these particular symptoms for making the diagnosis.
But has Alzheimer's now replaced the sort of old age dementia? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So we don't have any old age dementia anymore.
You can see what has been talked about a long time, which is called benign senile forgetfulness, which is basically having some difficulty recalling something. The term that I kind of sometimes use some is the following. If you have just the normal memory changes with aging, you forget, you remember that you've forgotten, and then you remember what you've forgotten. The person with Alzheimer's disease forgets that they've forgotten and could care less that they've forgotten. And so that gives you, that's actually not a bad distinction to make in terms of picking up this normal thing. Many older people will say, I'll go into a room with people that I know, I cannot recall her name. But 5 minutes later, I'm able to recall it. That's not Alzheimer's disease, or rarely would that be considered Alzheimer's disease. It's a normal thing that occurs. And a lot of people smile and I say, yeah, that happens to me all the time. Okay. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the demographic trends. A lot of people over the age of 65, about something like maybe 4.5 million individuals in this country will have the condition. It's going to grow by the time 2050, maybe 10 to 11 to 16 million individuals. A person who's diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease has an average life expectancy of about 8 years. And interestingly, and the data is fairly clear on this, though not dramatically clear, the younger you develop the condition, the more progressive it is, and therefore this life expectancy, like for a 55-year-old who develops Alzheimer's disease, may not be that much different than a 70-year-old who develops Alzheimer's disease. From the time of diagnosis, people with Alzheimer's disease survive about half as long as other individuals. And the annual cost of Alzheimer's disease, this doesn't sound like a very big figure these days, but a year ago, $100 billion sound like a lot of money. Okay. It does cost a lot of money. Okay. More than 7 in 10 people with Alzheimer's disease live at home. 75% of their care is provided by the family and friends. And what care they cannot directly provide, they will have coming in from outside or engaging some kind of professional help. And the cost to a family often averages about $19,000 a year if they are kept at home. So this can be a very significant expense, obviously. And that's just kind of the routine care that somebody who's staying at home will require. If somebody's needing 24-hour daycare, it goes much, much higher than this, obviously. One half of nursing home residents have Alzheimer's disease. The average lifetime cost of care is about $175,000. Now, again, considering what our incomes are and what we're able to spend, when you think you've got one family member who develops Alzheimer's disease, that's a lot of money. Medicare is very concerned about this condition because we've got people living longer. We've got more people aging into the Medicare age range. In 2010, they're estimating about $160 billion. Again, doesn't sound like much today, but it used to be a lot. Is going to be spent. Medicaid is also a major carrier of the care for Alzheimer's disease, primarily because if you have no resources, nursing home care in this country, at least right now in 2009, is paid for by Medicaid. And so these individuals are being supported by Medicaid. So in terms of what could be done about Alzheimer's disease, if we could find a treatment, not necessarily that cures it, but let's say delayed its onset or delayed its progression, it could have a profound impact on the public health issues and I think the quality of life of individuals and their families. One of the stages, it's sort of, you may have some memory problems, but it doesn't really cause impairment. Then you sort of go down to mild decline. We'll talk about this a little bit more. Then clearly Alzheimer's disease, moderate to severe decline. You begin to see real functional impairment. This is when families are beginning to raise the question as to whether they can keep the individual at home, all the way down to very severe declines, which lead inevitably to institutionalization, or just almost always, and then to death. The things that lead individuals to move from homes into institutions are not always what you would think it would be. I think most of us would think when he can no longer manage his bowels, that's when he's got to go. But that's not the thing that usually breaks the back of a family. What breaks the back of the family is more often than not wandering and waking them up at night. It does not take long of not being able to sleep on a regular basis. Family says, I can no longer manage her, I no longer can manage her. So when does it begin? Study done some time ago, the Nunn study, provides some very interesting insights into this. What they did in this study is they had nuns who were in a convent, and these have been nuns that have been in this particular convent for years and years and years and years, and they identified some who had Alzheimer's disease, compared them to some who did not. And what they found is that they went back and looked at autobiographical material that these nuns had written years ago, actually back even as early as the age of 22. And what they found was that the quality of the sentence structure and the nature of what was in some of these autobiographical materials helped in part to distinguish those individuals who developed Alzheimer's disease versus those who did not. Now, that does not mean that everybody who intelligent and writes well at the age of 40 is protected from developing Alzheimer's disease. Certainly, I've treated many professors and many doctors who've had this condition. However, on average, there seems to be some evidence that you could actually pick this up a lot earlier than you might imagine that you could pick it up. An area that's really received a lot of attention recently has been the area of mild cognitive impairment. This is not a particularly useful clinical term, but the investigators are crazy about this because it is sort of may allow somebody to identify individuals early on who don't have Alzheimer's disease, but who very well may be developing Alzheimer's disease. And therefore, if you could get them early, maybe you could try some treatments and see if you could prevent the onset of the condition. I think some form of mild cognitive impairment, I don't know if exactly what we call this, will actually make it into our DSM-5 categories. So what do we know about this? Well, this is from Ron Peterson, who's probably been one of the major advocates of this concept. And Ron suggests that what mild cognitive impairment is obviously it's not Alzheimer's disease, but it's having memory problems or some problems, cognitive problems, that are not normal for an individual's age. There's some cognitive decline, and but basically having pretty normal functional activities. And so he's divided this into two groups. One group are individuals who have clear memory problems and those who do not. And he calls them amnestic and non-amnestic, and he further subcategorizes them, et cetera. So does this really help us any? Well, there's no question that individuals who sort of get this diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment are more likely to develop Alzheimer's disease. In fact, it's a pretty high frequency. In other words, what you see is over a year, about 5% of those individuals who have this diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment will develop Alzheimer's disease, and that's considerably higher than you normally expect to see. Are there any neurocognitive tests that will predict Alzheimer's disease? In other words, could we take some kind of psychological test, and then that would tell us that we're going to develop it or show that we kind of got the early problem? Well, this would seem to be kind of a wonderful thing if we could do it, because neuropsychological tests, especially some of the more simple tests, would be a wonderful way to screen for this beyond just what we would do in a typical clinical interview. And there are a couple of tests that seem to be more related to Alzheimer's disease, but not all psychological tests are related to it. One is delayed memory. This is giving somebody something to remember and then doing something else for a period of time and then coming back and asking them to recall what they remembered before. Another thing that's been shown to have some relationship to this, which actually relates to executive functioning, is the trail-making test. How many of you are familiar with the trail-making test? We've got a few here who know what this is about. Basically, what it is, it's their number. Yes. Okay. Executive functioning is what many of us don't do very well, which is basically thinking logically and planning ahead, and being able to kind of put complex patterns together and work with them. Actually, the trail making test is a simple example of what executive functioning might be. So, for example, what the trail making test is, it has there's a page. And it has numbers and letters. So it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and it has A, B, C, D, E, F. So what the individual is asked to do is asked to start at 1 and then go to A, then go to 2, then go to B, then go to 3, then go to C. So you're having to keep a little bit more in mind there in terms of what you have to do. You're having to switch back and forth in terms of sets. And that particular test has been shown to be of some benefit in terms of predicting Alzheimer's disease. Now, there are other more extensive tests that would certainly help you to do this very easily, but these are a couple that have been shown to be of a special thing. I got some of this information from Marilyn Albert, who's done a lot of work in this area. She's now at Johns Hopkins. What about the pathophysiology? Well, we talked a little bit about that, but let me kind of go back over this again very briefly. There are gross findings and there are anatomical findings, and there are some neurochemical abnormalities. One, the brain does tend to shrink with Alzheimer's disease. This is just an example of that. Most of you can't really see this. The point I would make here, though, is you cannot do a CAT scan or an MRI and make the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, because there are people who have what look like to be perfectly normal brains. And on the other hand, they will have Alzheimer's disease, and there are individuals who have what appear to be significantly shrunken brains, and they're performing perfectly well cognitively. So this is not a one test. There's a correlation, but it's not a one-to-one test. this is sort of a cartoon of our neuroplaques and tangles that I talked to you about before. Typically, if you see these in the frontal lobe, that's where you are more, it's more likely to be indicative that an individual is having Alzheimer's disease. Whoops. Amyloid has been sort of I mentioned those plaques that were made up of beta amyloid. Amyloid has been a center of great attention. I'm not a neurobiologist, so I cannot explain this well, so I can put the cartoon up and tell you amyloid counts. Okay, so that's where I'm going to kind of leave it, except to say that it is important. Okay, and we'll get back a little bit later. Acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter that people have had most interest in. Our direct treatments of Alzheimer's disease, for the most part, have been directed toward trying to collect to see what perceives acetylcholine deficiency. You know, we've got a number of neurotransmitters in the brain, norepinephrine, serotonin. Acetylcholine is one of those, and this is the one that's been implicated in Alzheimer's disease. Okay, now, what about imaging? Well, we've already talked about the fact that you can see some shrinkage here. This is a Murali Duraswamy has kind of helped out with this, but you can see here the kind of opening up of these cavities in this Alzheimer patient, a little bit closed more in MCI and much more so in the normal individual. So that's one thing. But I think it's what's much more interesting, I'll get to this one in just a second. Another thing is a PET or positron emission tomography. And here we basically see that individuals with all sorts of different types of dementias will have less metabolism, which is often measured in PET scanning. And I think this is glucose metabolism in this particular case. And you can see here the Alzheimer patient sort of has, is compared to the normal, you see more blue and less red and yellow here. Of course, with Pick's disease, we're seeing even less. And you can see some other types of dementias with somewhat different patterns here. These are interesting experimental techniques. They probably don't help us much clinically at all, but there is something on the horizon that could. And that's the following. There is a compound called Pittsburgh Compound B, or PIB, which has an affinity for this amyloid that I've talked about before. And so you give the individual, by an injection, this PIB, and then you can image the brain. And what the PIB does is it goes and attaches to the amyloid in the brain and lights up. And therefore, when you do a scan such as this, you actually begin to see this. And so here we have, in contrast to what we were seeing before, this is the normal brain. So we're not seeing much. But here, the Alzheimer brain is kind of lighting up. We are seeing increasing evidence in recent years that this type of imaging can clearly pick up individuals before they show clinical signs who are probably much more likely to develop Alzheimer's disease because they already are laying down those plaques. And so that seems to be a very good. So there's a lot of excitement about this, even to the point that some of the more evangelistic individuals in this area would suggest that everybody at the age of 40 needs to get a PET scan and be, I don't know that I want to know. But nevertheless, this is the type of thing people are talking about. What's important to realize is that this really does kind of open up a window to understanding the progression of the disease before we see the symptoms that we really have not had before. All right. What are some of the risk factors for Alzheimer's disease? You know, who's going to get it? Who's not going to get it? Before we go through this whole long list, let me say the following, and that is, for most of us, our likelihood of getting Alzheimer's disease versus not getting it will have nothing to do with any of these risk factors. It will arise spontaneously. So I may get it, and Jeff Sharp may not, and there's no way you could predict that I was going to get it and he was not, except he's a state fan, maybe. I don't know. Okay, so what are the risk factors, though? Having said that, what are the risk factors? Well, the risk factors, increasing age. Obviously, I just showed you that slide sometime before. Heredity, and we'll come back and talk about that a little bit more. There is a definite hereditary predisposition, though 75% of Alzheimer's disease just arises sporadically. Down syndrome. Individuals who have Down syndrome, once they get into their late 30s, early 40s, they inevitably will have the symptoms and they will have the brain changes that are basically identical to what we see with Alzheimer's disease. That's led to an interesting area of itself. Blunt trauma, and here TBI becomes an issue. I think I'm going to get back to this, but there's a lot of interest in TBI that we see coming out of the conflicts in Afghanistan, Iraq, that may be related to later Alzheimer's disease, to the point that a recent Institute of Medicine report suggested that TBI is a risk factor with good evidence for Alzheimer's disease, which has the VA really concerned, because all of these individuals coming back, and they're a significant percentage from these the conflicts who've had TBI, if they develop Alzheimer's disease later, the VA could be responsible for their care. And so this is a very interesting area that we'll need to keep watching.
Dan?
Yes.
TBI is traumatic brain injury.
Traumatic brain injury, the milder forms, you have a concussion, you may kind of lose maybe consciousness for a very brief period of time. That's your mild form, and then there are certainly more severe forms of it as well. Okay? High insulin levels, this actually may be one of the reasons that statins, I'll get back to this, have actually been shown to be somewhat preventive of Alzheimer's disease. Many of us are taking statins for cardiovascular reasons, but there may be some other benefits as well. Higher education and cognitive stimulation. Again, having two advanced degrees doesn't necessarily help you all that much, but there's a correlation between education and this and have a decreased frequency of Alzheimer's disease. Now, what about TBI and Alzheimer's disease? This is an example of one study. There were 58 consecutive patients, mean age of 77, with residual closed TBI lesions, 57 age max controls, and what they found was that TBI was a risk factor in this particular study for Alzheimer's disease, and it was actually higher in subjects who were lacking APOE4. We're going to come back to APOE4 in just a moment. All right, what about inherited Alzheimer's disease? This is where Duke has played a major role in our understanding of this condition. I want to concentrate specifically on amyloid precursor protein, which is sort of what the Duke contribution has been. But there are a number of genes that have been associated with Alzheimer's disease. In fact, just a couple of days ago, there was an article, I can't remember where it was an article suggesting that 9 new genes had been found to be associated with Alzheimer's disease. And you'll see something like this once a week. But one that's clearly received a lot of attention is the amyloid precursor protein, and I want to come back to that when I talk about it. These other couple of genes here, the presenilin 1 and presenilin 2, are important because they're fairly rare mutations. But when they occur, the likelihood of Alzheimer's disease goes up pretty dramatically, much more so than with the amyloid precursor protein risk. On the other hand, the amyloid precursor protein risk is much, much greater in terms of just the frequency in individuals. All right, what about APOE gene, APOE4? It's a susceptibility gene. Not everybody who has the allele, let me just briefly explain this just for a moment, then I think actually I'm going to go to this little thing right here. APOE4 is a gene that actually probably relates to cardiovascular functioning, specifically in the blood vessels. It comes in 3 varieties, which have been labeled 2, 3, and 4. And as you remember your genetics, you remember you have 2 of these things, and so you can be a 2-2, you can be a 2-3, you can be a 3-3, you can be a 3-4, you can be a 4-4, or you can be a 2-4. So what has been found is that there is some protection from Alzheimer's disease if you have the E2 gene. And there's an increased risk if you have the E4 gene. And as you see over here, these are sort of the Alzheimer versus no Alzheimer. And sort of, if I can sort of show this here, it looks like that a little bit of protection here. By far, most people will have this E3 gene. Not a lot of difference. Here, this is where we see the big difference, and that is a much higher frequency of Alzheimer's disease versus no Alzheimer's disease with the E4 gene. This was developed here at Duke. Alan Roses was the person who really first brought this forward with a lot of his colleagues. And so, and this, I think, is perhaps the most important genetic finding in the 30 years that we've been really looking at this in detail that's come through so far. Even in spite of all these new genes that are coming up, this one is still the one people are paying the most attention to. Okay. Number of studies that looked at the risk. Again, most people who do not develop Alzheimer's disease who have this E4 allele of the APOE gene, but a higher percentage of individuals do. I'm going to go skip over that. So the question comes up, are there any biological markers for Alzheimer's disease today? In other words, can you go in and get a test and then know that you have it or know that you're going to get it? Well, the bottom line is no, there isn't. There are some things that are associated. And what makes this a little interesting and I think a little scary is that some of the things that are associated with Alzheimer's disease, in fact, are things that are going to be fairly inexpensive in the future, if not already inexpensive, such as you could do just do your genotyping. You probably could do it for about $60. And you could find out whether you're what your APOE genotype is without advice doing it, because it doesn't really tell you anything for certain, and it's just not clear that that's going to be that helpful to you, and it can lead to significant anxiety. If something comes along in the future where we truly can prevent, and we know we can prevent the onset or progression of the disease, then that may be very well something that individuals would choose to do. There are a number of other things we've talked about, brain volume, some correlations, not a marker. Glucose metabolism, some correlation, it's not a marker. Blood amyloids, another thing. Amyloid, beta amyloid, some association, not a marker. Then we kind of go on, and we talked about amyloid imaging of the brain. Yes, maybe even a little bit more of an association, but truly not a true biological marker. We can say individuals who have this have the disease. Those who don't have it don't have the disease. So we're learning, and we're gaining in our knowledge. But we're not at the point where we can say, go do this test, and then we'll know whether you've got Alzheimer's disease or not. It's still a clinical diagnosis. Yes? Yeah, most who have APOE4, if they don't live to be 100, do not get Alzheimer's disease, okay? All right. I'm going to skip on that. So what are the treatments that we have available to us today? Well, I'm going to, again, make a point that I've made before, and that is if we could delay onset, it could make a huge difference in what we see, because we've got a sort of an odd friend here, and it's called death. And that is people do not live forever, and therefore, even though the risk continues to go up with age, death may interfere before an individual develops Alzheimer's disease. So the goal of many treatments is to kind of take this line, which is sort of a normal line, and try to reduce it. Because, for example, if you were to reduce it for a group of individuals here who, in terms of millions, if you could bring this down, you could actually delay it 5 years. And that could make a huge difference in terms of what we're seeing. That's an important concept, I think, for us to keep in mind. So what can be done? Well, there are medications to treat memory impairment. We'll talk about some of those. There are medications to treat behavioral abnormalities. We'll talk about those for a moment. There is some concerns about attention to the environment, which I think is very important. And there are family interventions. I'm going to mention a little bit about each one of these. So there are a number of medications that are around that have been associated with maybe helping in Alzheimer's disease. And these have been tried in clinical trials and have been proven to be effective. I should say efficacious. It's not really clear that these are dramatically effective. The first one that came out of the gate was a drug called Tacrin, which is in fact was marketed as Cognex. It had a number of side effects and was taken off the market. Right? It may still be on it, but it's virtually never used. And so we really are left with three drugs that are out there for directly treating the memory impairment. And in terms of actually being what we call a cholinesterase inhibitor, and all that means is it leads to a relative increase in the concentration of acetylcholine. And there are donepezil, which is Aricept, you've heard some of these words certainly, rivastigmine, which is Exelon, and galantamine, which I can never pronounce what it is, but it's probably the least of the three that's used. But there are three drugs. There works specifically with cholinesterase inhibitors. Then we have another drug that's around that kind of works in a different way. It's N-methyl D-aspartate receptor agonist. Again, not my area. I'm going to try to explain it. But the drug has been around and is thought to be maybe of more value in the moderate to severe cases of Alzheimer's disease than would be the mild. These other drugs may be more valuable a little bit earlier in the condition. People have talked about using antioxidants, vitamin E. Given some of the problems with vitamin E, this is generally not recommended in general. And in addition, the evidence is not that great. Conjugated estrogens have been thought about, not particularly great. Then non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs have certainly been something to look at. Maybe some pretty good evidence there. Again, some of the original of this came from Duke, or certainly from a person who was at Duke, John Breitner. Another is ginkgo biloba, and that is not thought to be all that effective. The one that's received a little more attention recently are the statins, the thing we all seem to be taking after we're taking after a certain age. And there may be some real evidence about the statin. I think I've got a slide up here about that. Before I go on to sort of these other behavioral, let me kind of say something about this. For all of these medications, in a clinical trial, you can see that these individuals, on average, may be a little better than individuals who are in the placebo group or the control group. But that difference doesn't last over years. It probably lasts right now, according to the best evidence, up until about 6 to 9 months. And then those lines tend to converge. And so these drugs, even in clinical trials, do not appear to have long-term benefits. They appear maybe to have some short-term benefits, but not long-term benefits. From a clinical perspective, what I can tell you is that when we prescribe these medications, some people really believe that they see a difference, and families think they see a difference, and some see no difference whatsoever. And so I think it really, at a clinical level, I basically try to go with what the patient and family tell me, and usually will rely more on what the family's telling me than what the patient is telling me. So we've got some interesting drugs up here that might treat this condition, but nothing that we really can write home about and say, boy, we've really found the medication that's going to make a difference in this condition. Yes?
Before you move on to the other drugs, I'm curious about the cholinesterase inhibitors. Do you see increase in depression?
We actually don't. And sometimes they actually, I don't know why, we don't see it. We actually may even see a decrease sometimes.
Neurobiologically speaking, you could reduce the depression.
But for whatever reason, one of the effects of these medications that's been described, with galantamine, they've actually tried to study this in some detail, has been that it actually maybe has a positive effect on some of the behavioral consequences or correlates of Alzheimer's disease. So no evidence that it increases depression at all. It has some side effects. These drugs will cause some gastrointestinal problems. Some people have these sort of strange dreams at night with all these medications, but not depression. Yes?
Let me just ask, go back just a little bit to the education.
Mm-hmm.
Is that seeming to, saying higher education, you probably, are maybe less likely to develop Alzheimer's disease. Is that like exercising the brain? Is that, where's that coming
there
from?
There is, I think the thought is we don't have good solid evidence on what works where, okay? But I think the idea is that people who are educated tend to be more cognitively active as they age. So if you get a PhD and then decide you just want to go and hang out and do nothing for 40 years, I'm not sure you're going to be protected, okay? But if you get a PhD and the training that you get during your PhD makes you want to go read Proust and read Tolstoy, et cetera, then I think that's where they're talking about this actually making some difference. How it works, we don't know. Well, we frankly do not know what the mechanisms are. We just have seen this association. All right. So let's move on to the behavioral medications. And here, a lot of interest. And you see a long list of drugs here to try to control the behavioral abnormalities, Alzheimer's disease. Whenever you see a long list like this, two things are happening. One is that a lot of different drug companies have gotten into the game. But the second thing that's happening is that none of them really are all that great. And in this particular case, it's the second, probably much more than the first. Pharmaceutical companies have not been all that interested in studying these medications, though many of them have been studied. They're the antipsychotic medications. Probably the one that's been studied the most has been risperidone. Susan was just telling me about a Wall Street Journal article, that's right, just a couple of days ago or today or something, about the possibly increased risk of mortality in individuals who have who are taking these antipsychotic medications in nursing homes who have Alzheimer's disease. Now, the fact is there is a black box warning on the antipsychotics for treating behavioral abnormalities in Alzheimer's disease, and when that came out, it really created major problems for doctors working with these patients in nursing homes because they really felt these drugs actually were quite effective, and now they're having to deal with a black box warning. So that's an area that's still kind of being worked through. These drugs still are used fairly frequently for major agitation problems that we see in Alzheimer's disease. And again, the problems that are most difficult to manage in Alzheimer's disease are not the memory problem. It's not the agnosia. It's not the apraxia. It is these behavioral difficulties. It may be depression. It may be agitation. It may be paranoia. That's what's creating the problem. And a whole collection of other drugs have been tried and are used, in fact, off-label for the most part, because the only ones that really have any demonstrated benefit at all are the antipsychotics. Tegretol has been used. The antidepressants have been suggested. I've just got a couple of them listed, but there are a bunch that have been used. Propranolol, for example, has been suggested. Anti-anxiety drugs. So you have to be a little concerned about these because they can create some side effects of actually maybe even increasing the memory problem. All of these drugs have been used. Some things work in some individuals. Some things don't. Our scientific base here is dramatically insufficient given the amount of these drugs that are used with individuals who are suffering from Alzheimer's disease. Okay, attention to the environment. This, to me, is critical. I was involved in a study over at Vanderbilt many years ago where we looked at, in sort of ideal situations in a long-term care facility, whether, in fact, you could do away with the need for medications, and we actually showed that you could by very careful behavioral management of individuals in a long-term care facility. You could certainly decrease and probably in many cases eliminate the use of medications. Fact of the matter is there are virtually no long-term care facilities who have the staffing levels that can pay the attention and do this, and so people fall back on the use of medications. So what do you try to do? Well, you want to keep the old adult in familiar and constant surroundings. So if a person moves from a home into assisted living, for example, bring a favorite chair. Remember Frazier and his father? Okay, get that chair in there. Bring pictures, things that will remind the individual of where they are. That helps. But provide clear displays of calendars and clocks. In other words, having a big clock in the room, having a calendar that's easily read, sort of hard to miss it, helps a lot. Keeping daily routines. Routine is very important. So breakfast at a certain time, medicines brought at a certain time in relation to breakfast, etc. All of those things will keep the individual much calmer. They do not like having to deal with a unique individual situation. Medication schedule, simple. And this, you think about all the medications older people take, and you think about how they tend to take them. If they're at home, by all means, try to get them to have one of these pill dispensers and to use that and hopefully have a family member who comes in and actually fills it up every week and then sort of checks to be sure that they're used in a certain way and maybe even calls every day or every other day reminding the person to take the medications when. After I've made the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease in a patient, I will spend on average 5 minutes with the patient, 20 minutes with the family. But I really feel that once the condition condition gets into the moderate range, the family is my patient, because this is outside of the nursing home. Families are the ones who are bearing the burden. In the moderate phases, many times the Alzheimer patient is perfectly happy and content and has not a clue what's going on in many cases, and the families are very concerned dealing with major behavioral problems. So these are some of the things we do. Need to, as I said, spend adequate time with the families and listen to them and give them feedback in terms of what you think. So what are the types of feedback you might give them? Determine first what behaviors are most disturbing. What really bothers you? What is the thing that you think is going to be different? And it varies from one family member to another family to another. And if you identify something, help them develop strategies. About an optimistic yet reasonable information about what to expect. I always talk to families about, okay, let's think about what's going to happen over the next 3 months until I see you again, or next 6 months until I see you again. Third, help family members work through their grief. This is not my mom. And it's sort of like, you know, my mom has died, and yet she's still here in her body, and I'm really having trouble with that. Recognize that problem with grief. Refer family members to organizations such as the local chapter of Alzheimer's Association, et cetera. Okay. And by the way, these local chapters like the Alzheimer's Association is very important. Now, New Horizons, I'm going to go through this very quickly, but again, I've got some cartoons up here, but basically saying I think perhaps the biggest breakthrough we may see is in the area of a vaccine against that very amyloid we've been talking about. So I'm going to pass on over this. We've already talked about statins. Very good evidence that there may be some definite preventive value there. I'm going to skip over this one. And I'm going to talk for a second about exercise. Yes? Okay. I want to talk a little bit about it. I want to give some chances to talk and ask questions. Exercise is good for a lot of things, okay, regardless of what you do. You do not have to go out and run a marathon at the age of 70, okay. But if you can get the person up and walking maybe a block or two, there's good evidence now that that actually can make a big difference in terms of outcome for many problems in late life, including Alzheimer's disease, okay. So I want to just emphasize the exercise part of this, and one of the things we certainly try to do for a lot of reasons is get Alzheimer's patients up and moving around. So I'm going to pass on by that. So, conclusions. First, we've come a very long way since the 1970s. As I said, this area has just exploded, and something new is coming up virtually every day. And I can't keep up with it, and most people cannot keep up with it, unless that's all you're spending your time doing is looking at what's happening in Alzheimer's disease. But in spite of all these new findings, we've got a long way to go yet. So I'm going to stop here and give you a chance to ask questions, make comments, etc.
Is there an environmental correlation between Alzheimer's and...
Initially, there was a lot of interest in perhaps environmental toxins that might, in fact, lead to Alzheimer's disease. And the one that received considerable attention was aluminum, because you do see in some Alzheimer's patients an increased concentration of aluminum in the brain. And they even went so far as to say that there may be an increased frequency of Alzheimer's disease in those areas where aluminum tends to be mined in the world. So there was some interest in going from northern Australia up through Indonesia, up into to the Asia, I think maybe Japan, et cetera. They were thinking maybe there was an increased frequency. What's happened in recent years is that that's pretty well fallen by the wayside. It just has not held up. Now, I've had a colleague that I've worked with a little bit over at Chapel Hill who's very interested in the possibility of air pollution as being potentially causative or certainly contributing to Alzheimer's disease. And that's a very interesting possibility as well. There's no good evidence that the frequency of Alzheimer's disease is increasing. It's hard to do the studies because we'd really like to be able to see a 100-year trend. And 100 years ago, we just weren't making these diagnoses in older people. And so it's really hard to kind of look at this over that long period of time. But I think, you know, we may find something related to the environment, but nothing has jumped out. Nothing has really jumped out so far. Yes, okay.
In the beginning.
beginning, you talked about the diagnostics, and you mentioned ruling out something like, let me see what you said, vascular dementia.
Mm-hmm.
Two-part question. I'm wondering what vascular dementia is, and also, is it important to be able to distinguish between Alzheimer's and other dementias, and would you do anything differently? And
okay, good question. Questions obviously about vascular dementia. Okay, first thing I will say before I try to define vascular dementia is that there is a significant overlap between vascular dementia and Alzheimer's disease. So we probably a third to a fourth of individuals who have Alzheimer's disease also have signs of vascular dementia. And then of those who have vascular dementia, probably half of them will also have signs of Alzheimer's disease. So there's a lot of overlaps. But pathophysiology is very different. Okay, Alzheimer's disease is sort of what I've talked to about, has nothing to do with the vasculature except perhaps this APOE connection that we've been talking about, which is somewhat indirect. Vascular dementia is clearly caused by usually multiple small strokes. Almost always associated with hypertension, and so if you have an individual who has, you can look on the brain, and you can see these, you can see them in a scan pretty easily, and that would help you make the diagnosis of vascular dementia. So let's say you've got an individual who is hypertensive, a man more often than a woman. You do a MRI, and you see these areas of vascular insufficiency. Then you've got pretty good evidence the person has vascular dementia. If that person dies and you do an autopsy on the brain, chances are you're going to find Alzheimer's findings as well. But so that's the distinction that we make. So what do you do? Well, there's one thing clearly that you can do with vascular dementia that could make a big difference, and that is control hypertension. So, but you'd probably want to be doing that anyway. But the fact is, hypertension should decrease the frequency of vascular dementia. It has nothing to do, as far as we know, with decreasing the frequency of Alzheimer's. Progress. If some things like this vaccine against amyloid comes along, it's probably going to apply to Alzheimer's disease, will not apply to vascular dementia. So I think some of the treatment strategies would be very different. Really, you have to sort of think about vascular dementia in a similar way that you would think about a stroke. So what are the things that you would do to try to prevent a stroke? And think about vascular dementia in that sense. Alzheimer's disease, I think your overall treatment strategy is going to be very different. Now, when you get to the behavioral problems, you may begin to do some similar types of things. But in terms of treating the underlying problem, it's a very different kind of thing. Some of the other dementias, Pick's disease is characterized by what they call a frontal temporal dementia. It has some somewhat unique pathophysiological findings, much less frequent, I think, than we see in Alzheimer's disease. So there are some areas where you see a fairly high frequency of Pick's disease, frontal temporal dementia. For example, in Scotland, there seems to be a higher frequency there. We don't know all the reasons for that. Yes?
To what extent is recurrent depression or longstanding depression or other psychiatric disorders associated with Alzheimer's? You know, I'm just thinking of just hits to the brain. You talked about TBI, and certainly untreated prolonged depression could be a form of insult to the brain.
There is reasonably good evidence that individuals who have like a significant depressive episode in late life compared to individuals who don't are going to have an increased likelihood of developing Alzheimer's disease. Now, there's a kind of a the real distinction there, interestingly, is that individuals who experience a severe depression, they're going along normally, and let's say divide into two groups. You've got one group that develops a severe depression, but in the midst of that severe depression, they have virtually no cognitive impairment. You have another group that has a severe depression, but they have significant cognitive impairment as well. They're treated. They basically both come back to the same point. They look pretty normal. Okay, that group that had the cognitive impairment in the midst of their depression is significantly more likely to develop dementia than the group that did not have the cognitive impairment in the midst of the depression. Now, what may have happened in that situation is that the depression, the stress of the depression, may have uncovered a dementia. as opposed to causing a dementia. But I think the point is well taken. We don't have great evidence, but I think the point is well taken. The other part of this, and I know this is what you're thinking about to some extent, is that there's good evidence that depression leads to increased stress, which leads to hippocampal damage, and that clearly very well may be related to that. I think we're still kind of working through that, but I think multiple hits in terms of depression is certainly there's good neuropathological and evidence that should in fact increase the risk. Yes, Mark, go ahead. He's got the mic.
Dan, in one of your first slides where you were stressing the factor of age and the prevalence of Alzheimer's, there seemed to be a fairly clear difference between men and women in the prevalence in both.
I think those are actually numbers, and it has to do specifically to the fact that there are more women than men. Okay.
It's survival, then.
So it's really survival, and there's no, for Alzheimer's disease, there's no good evidence that there's actually an increased prevalence in women versus men or vice versa. Some have suggested maybe a little bit more likelihood in women, probably not good. But the real differences you see in these numbers have to do with the number of women versus the number of men. That was not a prevalence figure, it's actually just the numbers. Okay. Okay, go ahead.
Sorry.
And then we'll go back there, okay?
So just quickly, to recap, there's no actual treatment, right? You can't reverse symptoms, correct?
Probably cannot reverse symptoms. You might be able to slow them down temporarily with some of these medications we have, yes.
So, yeah, but you're talking about 6 to 9 months,
right?
You're not talking about... So what are you talking about then? How would you delay the progression? So you get diagnosed, say, at 65... You want to delay the progression for 5 years, correct?
Mm-hmm. So what can you do?
Right.
Okay. So one possibility would be that we get a better one of these drugs that actually have much longer-term effects. We don't know. It may be in a different class of medication that actually will push this out 5 years. That would be wonderful. Okay. Another thing we might find is that if this story on statins continues to evolve, we may find everybody 65 and older taking statins. Who can take them? And that may be what we do. I think that is a possibility. I'm not going to predict that and don't go out and buy the stock yet. Okay. But I think that is a possibility. We may actually find some kind of medication that we're going to be taking over a longer, certainly a longer period of time. So I think that's the type of thing that we may see. Or, as I said, these vaccines may come along or something like that actually may go in and actually begin to destroy some of these amyloid, and that could do it. And again, those vaccines may not be things that totally reverse it and you never see the problem again. They may be temporary, but if they could even just push it out a little bit, that could be a beginning to help. Need to go back there, yeah.
What are the statistics if you have, for a heredity, if you have one parent as opposed to both parents?
They're higher, but let's say you have one parent over the age of 70 who develops Alzheimer's disease. Then your risk is not much greater than just what your random risk would be anyway. You have two parents over the age of 70, and the risk in terms of your life, you can just go back and look at that slide. You know, if you live to 75, there's a certain risk. If you live to 90, there's a certain risk. So you kind of consider that your sort of average risk. Okay. If you have two parents, it's going to be a little above that. Okay. If you have a parent who has the onset, let's say at the age of 60 or 65. Then your risk goes up a little bit more, maybe 5-10%, something like that. If you have two parents who have the onset early, then your risk goes up significantly. Chances are there's one of these genes that we've been talking about, not the APOE gene, but the presenilin gene or something that actually may be playing a role there. So most of us are going to have parents who have this condition after the onset after the age of 70. There, the risk is just not that much. It's when the early onset and perhaps both parents, then I think that's when the risk increases. the mild level is where you sort of have a temporary confusion. You may not actually lose consciousness itself, but you have temporary confusion, usually almost always from a concussion injury. These shells explode, you know, create a vacuum, and that's what causes it. No direct damage to the brain, per se. Damage in the sense that no direct damage, like a penetrating injury or something like that. This is a hotly debated issue right now. What comprises TBI? What should be the threshold at which we should be concerned about this? It obviously has huge implications beyond just the scientific implications. But this has sort of become just a signature injury for this particular set of conflicts we're in at the present time. But there's a lot of debate about what defines what. I mean, I've got a friend of mine who is in the military, a very, very good epidemiologist, who is making a very strong case and has been greatly chastised for doing it, that these mild TBIs don't mean anything. And so what you can imagine sort of what the backlash from that might be. Yes?
It might be, a bit neurobiological, but the expression of the amyloid, where is it expressed in the brain? Or do we know enough about that?
Well, it tends to be expressed in the temporal lobes normally. That's where you'll see the plaques.
But on a microscopic level?
I don't know. What I can tell you is where you find the plaques normally are be in the temporal lobes, the hippocampal region. Where you tend to not find it normally would be in the frontal lobes. You're right. You're getting out of my expertise here.
I wanted to go back to
We'll go back to her in just a minute, okay?
The genetics. Does the correlation increase if you have a sibling versus parents?
Yes. I think any additional family members, it's going to increase in their statistics on that. I don't have them right now, but I mean, again, if you have a sibling, yes, your risk is definitely increased in that case. You're a twin, certainly it's increased. Okay.
Do we know why some Alzheimer's patients have the tendency to remember things from 30 or 40 years ago, but it's very difficult for them to remember things that just happened like 5 minutes ago?
Well, that's a very interesting question. This one's been around for a very long period of time. In fact, we used to think that long-term memory was intact, pretty much, in Alzheimer's patients, and it was a short-term memory. In other words, I can remember what I had for breakfast out of my honeymoon, but I can't remember what I had for breakfast this morning. That used to be the story on Alzheimer's patients. I think that's a little misleading because there's no question Alzheimer's patients can have memories from the past. I think what evidence has suggested is those memories many times are somewhat distorted. In other words, they're not always as accurate as we might think they are. Now, that doesn't mean that people cannot remember. One interesting thing is, for example, I've talked to some people who worked with Alzheimer's patients who've been very regular churchgoers all of their lives. And then they develop Alzheimer's disease. And one of the things that they retain, they can sing the songs. They can sing the songs. Even if they cannot remember, they have difficulty to talk. Sometimes you start singing a particular song that's very familiar, they can sing that song. And so there certainly is something to sort of connecting back into old things. I can remember very early on when I was a resident, having a patient who clearly had Alzheimer's disease, was having major problems with his memory. He was an accountant. And so one of the things we do is serial sevens. I said, I want you to take 100, subtract 7, and subtract 7. And then he said, 193, 86, 79, 72. And I was just, right down he went. And I was wondering, what in the world is going on here? Well, he's been doing, that was an overlearned, something that he said is overlearned, Alzheimer's patients will tend to retain. And you may see that come back. But in terms of all of these memories that they sort of are reflecting back on, some of those probably are distorted. Yes, right here. Let me get the mic back up here.
You reminded me that my mom has Alzheimer's, and one of the things I learned from the experience is learn to count from 100 backwards, by 7, because that's the standard test almost.
Yes, it is.
I was surprised by that.
Yeah, that is the standard test, and that's the one that everybody uses. We probably ought to change it around a little bit. Maybe the 9s or something.
end, they are very violent. What is happening in the body opposed to another patient that does not, you know, have that behavior?
That's a very good question. And the bottom line is we really don't know. But what we imagine is happening is that, again, this is a disease that's affecting multiple parts of the brain. Okay. And it doesn't affect everybody equally in equal parts of the brain. So there may be somebody who is having much more difficulty in one portion of the brain, or somebody who's having more difficulty in other parts of the brain. And that's why we have sort of differential symptoms. And so, you know, you see these fairly dramatic cases that are presented to us. For example, you have the individual who has always been just as docile and sweet and nice as she ever might be. Develops Alzheimer's disease, and literally she comes after her husband with a knife. And then you have the situation where there's been, and I have a friend of mine who this has happened with. She was a terrible person. I don't know, I hate to say it. I mean, she just was. Just a real, I won't say the word, but you know, the B word. She got Alzheimer's disease. Her personality just changed, the most mild, compliant, wonderful individual, friendly. I mean, it was just amazing. So I think what's happening in these situations is that, you know, parts of the brain are affected, and then there are others who've been snakes, and they continue to be snakes. Okay, so it's just going to be a lot of variation because of where I think it's affecting the brain. I mean, one other example, not related to personality, but for example, if you look at something like aphasia, I've got two patients. I've got one patient who has what I would consider to be he's close to having to be put into an institution. His wife is having a lot of difficulty managing him. His speech is totally normal. No abnormalities in his speech whatsoever. But another patient who has clear memory problems but still lives alone, functions fairly well living alone, she can hardly express one sentence where you can understand it. And so you just, again, see a lot of differences in the way present the different symptoms. They both have Alzheimer's disease, but it's where it affects the brain. Huh?
I have a question. Both patients have.
She can write, but she can't talk. Yes?
Where do they hope that the stem cell will help in finding a cure?
I think in this particular situation, I probably stem cells is not going to be a major factor. Like something like Parkinson's disease, I think it make a huge difference. But Alzheimer's disease, probably not, because it's unlike Parkinson's, where you have a deterioration of a particular type of cell in an area of the brain, and we know what that cell is, and we can develop stem cells that actually can replace that and actually insert them. Alzheimer's is more wide-ranging, and it's not the destruction of the cells per se that create the problem. It's I go back to these plaques. These plaques are toxic within the brain. And the fact that they're toxic in the brain, they're creating problems around them, which is probably the tangles, the neurofibrillary tangles that we were talking about before, probably are secondary to what's going on with the plaque. And so we need something that can go and actually destroy these toxic agents in the brain as opposed to creating new cells. And again, because the damage is so diffuse, it's probably going to be difficult for stem cells to go in and replace a number of neurons.
Would an image to maybe help grasp the concept with folks in the room be that the tangles as more like the power line communication between the cell body and the terminal?
Yes.
That in the tangling you have delayed communication across a neuron, but that with the plaques, you have a traffic jam in the synapse.
That could possibly be it. I think the other thing that may be happening is these tangles tend to occur around the plaques. In other words, so what may be happening is something may be going on in those plaques that's in turn affecting these nerve cells that are in some near proximity to the plaque, and that in turn leads to the tangles.
So plaques are directly affecting the myelination.
They could be. I don't know.
In theory.
Yeah,
okay.
They could. But they're basically, these plaques are just, they're there. They're pretty good size, and then there's all sorts of brain tissue around them. The idea is that the plaques are, in fact, affecting that brain tissue that's around them.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yes?
Do you have any
Yes.
What do Alzheimer's patients generally die from?
They don't die from Alzheimer's disease, or they do very rarely. If they die from Alzheimer's disease, they will die from just basically a total. When the disease gets so severe, it begins to affect areas in the base of the brain that have to do with regulation of bodily functions. You know, hypothalamus area, not the hypothalamus, but I guess it's the hypothalamus. That's when you begin to see sort of a breakdown of systems, and so that will happen. Most often, Alzheimer patients will die of what most of us die from, but probably are at increased risk for it because of health habits and maybe things that are happening in the brain that accelerate that process in ways that we perhaps don't really understand at the present time. But my guess is that what mainly pushes Alzheimer patients to die early is the fact that the brain overall is just not working as well as it once did. And that in turn is creating all sorts of just sort of diffuse problems to the body. My son is a cancer surgeon. I was asking, you know, why do people die from cancer? And he says, you never know why they actually die from cancer. You just know that things start going wrong gradually and then they die. And I think that's sort of what's happening here too, is that we don't know exactly, you know, people, you know, got things that you mark them out on an autopsy. We don't know exactly why they die, but just things start going wrong. Okay, that's all. System breaks down. I think, yeah, the old term homeostasis. I mean, it just, that's what breaks down. Okay, listen, when we go one more, we probably need to stop, okay?
So I have an aunt who's got Alzheimer's. My mom, I'm sure, had some vascular dementia because she had multiple mini strokes. My aunt's been on both on Aricept, Namenda, and statins, and I'm not sure that they're doing anything. But with the information that you said, that really, if they're going to do anything, it's probably only going to be for 6 to 9 months. And of course, these newer medicines are hugely expensive. You know,
yes, that's right.
Close to $1,000 a month with everything. Mm-hmm. It sounds like it might be reasonable to discuss with her physician just stopping them.
Yes.
It sounds after a year or two, if we're not seeing anything.
And I think, you know, you know, she's on both. Aricept
and Namenda and statins.
Probably what I would do is stop one,
mm-hmm,
and see if that makes a difference. And then if it doesn't, then maybe stop another one, see if that makes a difference. My guess is that she's
stop the Aricept probably because that's been the one that's fine. Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of how we would tend to think about it. Now sometimes people will say, look, she went off the medication, she got a lot worse, let's get her back on it. But you can notice that.
Sure.
Okay, well, listen, thank you very much. Thank you. Okay.